I believe we have the brochure, or I think it, give it to somebody that will come for Good Friday, Easter, and Sunday, evening, and evening. Okay? My wife is sharing this morning, and as I was thinking about what to say about this speaker, I have so much to say. We were teenage friends to begin with. And we were in a season of revival. We all did our dating in the church. That was the place we were drawn to by the presence of God. And we never stopped for the last 38 years in our marriage, 6 years of courtship. So 44 years, I can say so many, don't ask us how old we were. But you know what, the Lord gripped her heart. She was willing to follow this preacher who was supposed to be a lawyer in the initial stage of life. But she was willing to follow and pack our bags and just went anywhere the Lord would send us to be a blessing, because we only have one life to live. So I'm praying, Jasmine, we will have another 12 years of marriage and celebrate our 50th golden anniversary. I believe in God. If I eat less, and you eat less, and if we are showered by love wherever we go, I'm quite sure we will live a long time to be a blessing. Just a minute, come before you scold me.
You know how when people shower us with love, they give us food, they feed us all the time. So, right. You know, today's message is actually inspired. Many times this week, we had a very eventful week, meeting up with some people that came to see us in the office, meeting Brother Kenny and Melinda and some others. And I was preparing this message that you are designed to be different, to make a difference. It was confirmed. And Brother David Ng, you know Brother David Ng? He's a former Thomas Cup player. Is he here today? Can I see your hand? Brother David, he's sitting quietly, but why to see him? And so kind of them, it turns out for a nice Indian banana leaf rice. Again, they feed us in love. You know, when he was sharing with us, his passion and tears fell up in his eyes as he began to talk about his desire to make his life count. He wanted to make a difference with the remaining years that God has given him. I mean, he's busy enough coaching people and playing badminton, yet deep inside his heart, he was stirred. And as I was listening to him, I said, thank you, God, for confirming that this is the message that you would like me to share with the people this morning. It is taken from Romans chapter 12, verses 4 to 8. Romans chapter 12, verses 4 to 8. Can you turn with me to your Bibles, to your background, or of my message this morning? Yes, thank you for that. Just as many of you, just as each one of us is one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function. You together with me, so I'm not alone. So, in Christ, we are many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. Let's stop there for a moment. Different gifts. Okay, just bear that in mind. We go back to our slide. We have different gifts. So why would you want to make a difference? Why would you want to listen to me this morning to make a difference? Because fruitfulness in our life increases when we live according to how we are designed. Look at the picture of this lush durians. Okay, we're not asking you to produce durians, right? We are made to multiply. Isn't that what God says in the Garden of Eden when He made man? Be fruitful and multiply. I'm not just talking about biological children. Now He tells the animals and the trees that they will what? Multiply after their kind. And what kind of people are we made of? We are made in the image of God. And therefore we are made to multiply that godly character in our children, in our spiritual children, and people whom we can mentor. We are created to consume. More than that, we are created to contribute, not just consume. And I'm not asking you all again, is it just to consume durians and produce durians? But you know, when we consume, like say, growing in the Word of God, we will delight to serve and be transformed and transform others. Let's give an overview of what I want to tell you, because I can run a few things, but the three main points I want to share with you this morning, the next slide, overview, is that firstly, I want to share how you are designed differently. Each one of us, I look at you, all of you are so beautifully designed. Number two, how you can make a difference. And thirdly, how you are designed to function as part of the church. So the first point is, you are designed differently. First point, thank you. A, you are gifted differently to express different facets of God's character and His image. Just think about it for a moment. This morning you sang about the song, The Servant King. And just as Jesus came to serve, He's a servant king, right? And to reflect the image of God as a servant, we are given the gift of serving. And the gift of mercy is given to most of us because God is rich in mercy. And you realize that the gifts given to us are actual reflection of the image and character of God. The gift of giving is reflecting the image of a God who gives bountifully. Do you see that? Now, B, you are designed to function in your gifts. But how do you recognize your gifts? You may say, I got gift, man. Some of us, very humbly. How do you recognize that you have a gift? You know, when the Holy Spirit came to live in you at salvation, He brought along with Him His gifts to reside in you. Each one of you are actually given gifts. Now, which is my gift? How do you recognize it? A gift is a God-given ability or a capacity. It means even though you may not see the ability now, but there's a capacity to develop and improve on it. You have a desire in the first place to perform a function or an assignment within the body of Christ with supernatural joy, energy, and effectiveness. I was happy to hear from Pastor Brother Kenny when people asked him, Brother Kenny, you're not tired, man, every Sunday transcribing the message, and then after that go back and upload onto your website. Doesn't that take a lot of your time and effort? He says, I don't feel tired. I feel joyful because it is my passion. And he said that, and I was going, yes, Kenny, that's what I want to talk up to the people today. You'll feel energized and you are effective because the website, many people visited, about these 30 likes, 30 people who visited it, and it has blessed them. Now, I don't mean to pigeonhole ourselves or others into precise ministry, but it's useful to understand your gifts. We may have a combination of gifts, but every one of us have gifts or abilities that ought to be developing in us. Example, We are not all teachers, but we are all encouraged to teach one another in Colossians 3:16. And we may not all have the gift of serving or being a helper, but all of us are urged to help and serve one another, right? So this is what I want to lay the foundation about gifts. Finally, secondly, how can we discover where we can make a difference? Okay. Now, if you look at the next, at this slide, okay, you'll find that all of us have passions and personalities different from each other. We have giftings, okay, talents, and supernatural giftings. But there are also, how do we combine these two with the Holy Spirit's function or impressing us, drawing us? How can we meet a need around us in our community, in our world, in our workplace, in our school, in our neighborhood? Is there a need? How many of you may not realize that? I go down to the children's church and observe sometimes there are two kids that walk by themselves to the children's church. They cross the road. They are not members of our, the parents are not members of our church. And they come. But sometimes you feel that they are not listening to the lesson. They don't seem to participate. And some of you say, hey, what for they come to church? I'm gajal. No. I say, thank God they are here. What can we do to, to bond with them, to relate with them, to draw them to Christ? I'm thankful for some of the young people that come. Daniel, for example, he has a heart of compassion for these kids. Then he will come and sit with them and put his arms around them and talk to them. And then Brother Alvin and Eunice, they said these kids, they love music. They're very fascinated by the guitar. And you see them, that when we get them excited about certain things that they like, they stay, they keep on coming. We're friends, we need people like that. You have a heart for children. Just come and sit with them, make friends with them. Say how you can connect with them. And then more mentor them. Who knows, next time you might see them up here in the church leading the worship. What other needs can you see in your community? Find a sweet spot. Now what is a sweet spot? If you play golf, you will know that when the ball hits the spot, hit the ball at the right contact point, it will fly. It goes ding! You know, my husband and I play golf, so we can talk about golf. But I'm sure, Reuben, it's football, you know, you hit the ball at just the right point, you will see it go woo into the air, get the goal, right? But if you hit it wrong wing, it won't go very far. So what I want every one of you to find your sweet spot. No, not a sweet tooth, okay? Sweet spots. Right? And that's where you say, yes. Next slide, I want to show you one tool to discover how God has designed you to achieve His purpose and to fulfill His plan for you and for His world. Let's explore together the story, S-T-O-R-Y, that God has written in your life. Okay, this next slide is strength. S stands for strength. What are your strengths? Each one of you has strengths. You have talents, abilities. What is the topic T for topic? What do you enjoy talking about, working with? I know that some of you here are very passionate about badminton. The young people will say, yeah, no, for uncle and auntie only. But the young people, what do you enjoy talking about? How do you with yourselves? Observe. Okay, some of you I know are passionate about football. And what are the optimal conditions that motivates you? Some people, what will trigger your motivation? Some people need an audience. An audience, they enjoy the limelight. They enjoy coming here and sharing testimony. But there's some who prefer to work in the background. They're more reserved. God can still use you. Okay, there's some in the multimedia there. And we need to know what is your relationship pattern? Do you enjoy working in a team with people? Or do you enjoy working on your own, on small groups? Some people here are very people-oriented, and the ushers. I'm sure you are very people-oriented. You come every Sunday, you greet people with a big smile, and you make them feel welcome. You're passionate about that. But there's some who are more task-oriented. There are people who will get a project done and they say, I want to do it well. So there are different types of people in the church. And finally, why? Yes. When you find the sweet spot, you will say, yes, I was made to do this. I was born for this. Amen. And I want to help every one of you to use your story for God's glory. Tell us together, I will use my story for God's glory. Thank you. But number two, how can you make a difference? Bible says that these are given for us to equip and train the saints. How can I use my God-given gift to edify, to build up, to strengthen, to encourage one and other people? And how can this help us to unite in the faith? Look at the different gifts that are there. Exhorting. Some of you are very good in encouraging. Some of you are very good in leading. It's like God is a leader. Or in assisting. Just come and assist the teachers. Exhorting. Come and exhort the youth. The youth impact group. On Saturdays we meet at 2:30. Come and encourage them to be moms and dads. Be tete, be koko to them. Okay, evangelism. Some of you just feel that I've got a burden to share the gospel. And some of you have the desire to pray or have compassion on the world. The example of the church in Acts, we can see how did the church then use the gifts. In Acts chapter 4, verse 34, we see a story of a man called Barnabas. I like to call him Barney, because he seems like a very friendly person. And throughout the whole text, we see him as an encourager. In fact, his name means son of encouragement. Barnabas saw the need in the community. At the time, there were a lot of widows, a lot of poor people in the church. What did he do? What did he have? He had a piece of land. And he sold it. He brought the money to the apostles' feet and says, give it to the needy. And I was wondering, what do you have? Which one of you? David had a sling. Do you have a car? Do you have, a spatula to cook something? And I believe some of you have got a heart's desire. So what is it we can bring to the Lord today? Dorcas used a gift to do good and to help the poor. Acts 9. She was helping to make clothes for the widows. And all of us, some of us are here, have such a compassion. And there's a love project in TOB every third Sunday where they reach out to the community with food and teaching. Teachers are needed to help reach out to the kids around our community. And what did Philip have? Philip used his gift of event to evangelize an Ethiopian official. Acts chapter 8. Now, it doesn't mean that only those who have the gift of evangelism can evangelize. So, I don't have the gift, love. But every one of us are called to do the Great Commission. And there are some tips here. What did Philip do was, he went near to the carriage. When you go near to a people, form a relationship with them. Listen to their needs. And here, when Philip listened, he was asking, how can I understand the scripture? So some people have needs, they cannot understand certain things. Or they may have stress, or they have a need, for emotional need. What we can do is listen to their felt need, and then we can share. Turn our conversation into a spiritual conversation where we lead them to know the Lord Jesus and His love for us. In the Acts church, there were prophets and teachers in Acts 13. See that there were apostles and evangelists. These are the leaders that caused the church to grow. And they were put there to certain giftings. The apostles knew how to set things in place. They were there, and God gave them the ability to lead. There are those who gave the ability to teach clearly the word of God, explain Like some of you here, you know Brother Ooi has got this gift, and others too. And Sister Melinda, she herself told me she has the gift of exhortation. She just loves to come alongside people to encourage them. And then in Acts chapter 3, you see that how can you use your gifts today? In the book of Acts, they use the gifts. But today in TOP, you can use your gifts to edify, that means to build up to one another, to enlarge the church. Okay? The word build up excellence means to, not like when you build a house, I want to extend my house, make it bigger. So that word build up is the meaning of strengthening and to extend. How can we extend? Things like, you find that today you can make a difference with your gifts, either in sharing the word, or in teaching a class, or being a pastor, having a pastoral gift. As a cell leader, you are actually being a under shepherd or a pastor to your flock. You are designed to function. Thirdly, you are designed to function as a part of the church. Okay, as you look at all these people there, together, every one of them, you know, they make up. We are living stones. You make up the church. The church is not just a brick and wall and concrete. It's not just a building, but it is made up of people of different colors, different sizes, and each one is doing their part to support one another. But the Bible says, from him, the whole body, now this verse is up here, you know, and I asked the young adults on Tuesday, can you tell me the verse that's been sitting or standing rather up here on your wall for a whole year? Something like that. And then they say, what? No, we never see one. We're standing behind the worship. But all we can see, right? Okay. So put this to mind, to memory. Read together, okay? From him, the whole body joined and held together by supporting ligaments, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Look at the hero there, you know? He's got his organs in place, but what is holding the organs in place? You need all the supporting ligaments, bones and joints, right? In order to grow. Each one of you here, you're part of the body. Some of you are the mouth. You love to got the gift of the gap. Love to talk. Okay, but it's not a spiritual gift, by the way. Okay, you love to share. And you go to young adults meeting, they end very late because they all love to talk, love to share, and love to eat also. But they have so much fun bonding together. And you are next slide now. You are designed to function as a part of the church. Jesus, look at the Jesus. You are many members, but the one body of Jesus Christ. And he loves each one. You're all special. No one is unimportant. You know, one pastor here in Penang, he had one of his toes, he lost one of his toes to gangrene. His diabetic. He said that after he lost his toe, he was like learning to walk again. Because he didn't realize one toe can make a significant difference in the way you balance yourself, in the way you hold yourself. And some of you may say, hey, I'm just a toe lah. Nobody recognizes, nobody sees me, you know. But you are vitally important. If you are missing one Sunday, you're a big vacuum in the church, okay? And it's a spiritual gift working together, just like interlock. Okay, all working together. And without one of you, something is missing. The next slide. God has designed different, you look at different people of all ages and to serve various roles. Some got grandmother there, got holding the tongkat. But they're all actually important. Okay? And we are designed to pull together. Pastor Ron and I had the privilege of going to visit the prayer house in Penang Hill. And we took this new train, okay? And this new train, we were told that, and as we're going up the hill, it suddenly stopped. I said, what happened? Tiana, no electricity, is it? No, then Pastor Ron took us up, said, it's like that, they work together as a pulley system. When one stops, the other also must stop. And so we were stopping in the middle of nowhere. There's no train, no station, there was no stop. But we just were hanging there and we just waited. Many of us are like that. We are a team. And if one of you decide to stop, you will slow the other person down, the team down, or you will make a stop completely. So I just want to encourage you. You are so important. God has also designed each different people to serve famous roles, like members of a championship football team. Now, you know Ruben is our star player, Penang, huh? Okay? Ruben, what position do you play?
Defense!
Defense! Wow! You know, one day we went to a 7-Eleven outlet, Pastor saying, wow, the Malay boys team at the counter suddenly stand up, go there, oh, high five! You know, they could connect with Ruben. But, you know, that if you're a defense, you wouldn't want to go and play striker, right? You have to know what the function is. And I mentioned championship, because Pastor Ron used to play the kampong, the village. And so when the ball comes, everybody goes to the ball. Defense, star, striker, everybody's going for the ball. No position, right? The ball could have been everybody go to their ball. And so I mentioned championship. I know all of us want to do everything together, but we are all gifted with various gifts to serve various roles and to hold various positions. And, okay. The next slide, I want to start sharing a lesson from the geese. You know, have you ever seen geese flying in the air in the evenings? You see them flying in a V formation? It was very, very interesting to see that. This talks about high performance teamwork. It's a natural unity that exists among the species. The same unity can exist in our church. The first lesson is that as geese flap their wings, they create an uplift for the bird following. It will help them, this uplift, it will help them fly further and cover more ground. Isn't that what we want? What can we learn from this? It's a powerful, by flying in a V formation, the whole flock at 71% greater flying range and if any bird were to fly alone. So we can fly further and fly higher. As we learn about this natural unity, you understand that sometimes we have somebody at the point position. Next slide, you'll find that. What can we learn? Firstly, share a common direction and a sense of community. We can get to where we are going more quickly and easily because we are traveling on the thrust of one another. So you flap your wings, we're actually creating energy for the next, for the person following. Secondly, whenever a goose falls out of formation, it suddenly feels the drag and resistance of trying to fly alone. And then it quickly gets back into formation to take advantage of the lifting power of the bird immediately in front. One question I want to ask you, are we all headed in the same direction? Do we have the same destination? What is our goal? Our goal is to grow up together, build one another up as each part does its work so that we can all reach the fullness of Christ. And so we will have the same goal. Make sure this happens even in family, in marriages. If we have the same vision, same direction, then we know we can come together, not pulling each other apart. The Pastor Ron says we have been married 38 years. But after 30 years, we realize we are very different. You know, he's got his personality is more of a driver. You know, driver? Not drive the truck. A driver is the one to push things forward and has a great vision. But sometimes he drives me up the wall. Yeah. But I recognize his gifting. And so he casts the vision of our family. Yes, we will all pull together and go forward in this direction. So our children and us will respect and honor for him for that. And I am more of an I personality. I wish I'm an inspirer. I I like to influence people through persuasion, but I can be quite impulsive. And so sometimes the tea person will help me to recognize to not to be so impulsive. So, but then, because we are so different, we can sometimes get at loggerheads. But we also realize that we make a very wonderfully perfect couple, because he's wonderful, I'm perfect. So all the wonderfully perfect couples here. Okay, secondly, just remember that, okay? If we have as much sense as a ghost, okay, we will stay in formation with those who are headed where we want to go, and be willing to accept others' help as well as give our help to others. Stay in formation, T.O.P., then you will reach the top, right? And learn from those, the geese. Number three, when the lead goose gets tired, it rotates back into formation. Another goose flies at the point position. This is vital for church leadership and unity. But what we learn from here is that we should take turns doing the hard task and sharing responsibility. If not, the person in the point is facing the greatest resistance from the wind. Right? And like geese, we are interdependent on each other's unique arrangement of gifts, of skills, and resources. So when the big person is tired, what will he do? He will actually sometimes slide backwards and let somebody else take the point of the lead position. So sometimes some of the teachers in Children's Church have been serving for 10 years. More than 10, some of them. And they've been faithfully missing service so that they can come and teach their children. So once in a while, let them take time off so they can come and just sit in the service and be refreshed once more. But we need other people to come and fill their place. And it's great, it's a great opportunity for us to use our gifts to bless these children, to raise them up to their future Ethiopian leaders. Now fourthly, the geese in formation, number four please, yes, the geese in formation honk from behind, honk honk, okay, why? To encourage those up front to keep up their speed because they're tired. Now, a word about honking, huh? If we honk, we need to make sure it is positive and encouraging. So where there is encouragement, the production is greater and the leaders can fly further, longer. So he says, speaking the truth in love will cause growth and edification. How do we speak the truth in love? Make sure it is from the love first. And then when we speak it out, we will encourage the other person. Does it encourage the person? Or it's not just downloading, it's not just letting go or not outburst, but it is, will that person be encouraged? Will that person grow as a result of my honking? Alright. Then fifthly, okay, when a goose gets sick or wounded or is shot down, two geese drop out of formation and follow it down to help and protect it. And they will stay with that goose, the injured goose, until it's able to fly again. Guys. They then launch out on their own with another formation, or they'll catch up with the flock. So very interesting effect about the goose. Number five, the lesson is that if we have as much sense as geese, we will stand by each other in difficult times as well as when we are strong. You look alongside every great achiever and you will find caring people offering encouragement, support, and able assistance. Each one of us will be thankful to God for people that have come alongside you to mentor you, to assist you when you are down. And all of us have got times when we may need others to come alongside. So just bear that in mind. What lesson can we learn from team building? Stand by each other. Let's all try to fly in formation. Remember to drop back to help those who might need it. 1 Thessalonians 5:14 says, help the weak, be patient. You know, I have such a desire to help people, to counsel, to help them back on their feet. And I want to train people too. I can't just do it all by myself. And I would like, those, even if you like it and you have a passion to help people, and you want to be trained, let me know. Maybe we can form a class to train you all, or a few people at a time. I also have a desire to help married couples to strengthen their marriages. And we can even teach a class called the Marriage Course, where there are about 7 lessons, where we actually interact. It's not just a seminar, it's actually a course where couples sit together and then they work through certain issues together. We need strong marriages in our church, don't we? All of us have needs. God has made us to fly together. So let us learn to help the weak, be patient. I also want to help parents as they struggle with raising their children. How to raise them up to be godly and through the stresses of life. There's also a parenting course that we can run. We need people who are interested for my class. People who want to come alongside us and help us to train parents, see them through their childhood years. There are 2 courses. One is for childhood years, the other one is for teenagers. Okay. But the greatest accomplishments in life are not achieved by individuals alone. We are trainers, but we need people to train. But it's by proactive people pooling together for a common good. Remember the train. Okay? Now how can we apply this today? How did the church help members to function as a team to resolve a crisis in the midst of revival? In Acts chapter 6, there was a crisis. The Christian Jews complained against the Hebraic Jews because the widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. Here, they were having spirit-filled revival, people getting saved suddenly, and then you got a lot of poor people in their midst. So they were feeding. And somehow, you know, there are different types of Jews. Those who were born in Palestine, they were the Hebrew Jews, and those that were born outside, they were born in Greece, and they speak Greek. They speak Greek rather. So sometimes there's a disparity. Wow, we are the purer Jews, no? And the Greek Christian Jews sometimes feel that we are second class. Now there may be that kind of feeling sometimes happen in the church, but how did this crisis get solved and not become a split, not become, you know, a big problem? We look at how the church functioned as a team. Apostle Peter stood up. He, you know, God gave him the apostleship in order to see through problems and able to set structures and systems in place. And he, as an apostle, was able to embrace people of other giftings. That's one of the true mark of an apostle. He said, choose 7 men from among you who are full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom. He empowered them. Okay, instead of saying, I pao ka liao, it means I do everything myself. Any problem, come to see me. No, we couldn't handle that. He needed men. And we will turn this responsibility over to them and will give so that we can give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the word. And as a result of that, the word of God spread and the number of disciples increased rapidly. So there are some of you here who are called the servant heart to serve, men of wisdom who are able to give advice, to lead the church in a church board and so forth. Therefore, we see how the church functions as a team. But as you know that sometimes, what are some of the basic reasons for people having problems? Many times, not that our psychologists tell us, the three main needs of human beings are a need for esteem, a need for security, and a need for significance. And for this, widows feel, I'm not esteemed by my apostles, and I feel insecure. Maybe they've forgotten about me. Or they feel, am I significant enough to make a difference? If you look at every issue of your life, God made us packaged with needs, but He meant for us to have our needs primarily met by Him. It's like we said, I am accepted by God, loved by Him, I am significant in Him, He esteems me as a beloved child. When that is settled, then you find that other things become less touchy. Other people not become antagonize you as much, because you realize that we have needs, and we also can help others recognize and feel those areas in their life where these needs are. So if we can help each one, hear them out, and bring them to recognize that their needs can first of all met by God, then we have done a big job already. In conclusion, every one of us should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, the Bible says, 1 Peter 4 verse 10. Faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms, different forms. 1 Timothy, Paul tells Timothy, don't neglect the gift. Stir up the gift. It means that gift of us can lie dormant in us. Okay. But God's gifts are irrevocable. Doesn't mean he gives to you. No, don't use it. He takes it away from you. No, Father Danny shared me a very interesting story. Danny, are you here?
Yes.
He said one time God asked him, got an impression on his heart to pray for somebody who is sick. But the person is not a very, not a simple sickness. It's a big disease. What sickness? Okay. This is good. Okay, it's a complicated sickness. And he was having boo. No matter or not, should go and pray for that person. So he said, okay, I got something inside bite me on my leg. Maybe I try first. I pray for this itchiness and this to go away. If it work on me, then maybe I can pray for that person. No, I will have faith. Pray for the person. Pray, in Jesus' name, go away. Then I think, little bit. More and more. I think we get to see doctor. Then I said, maybe I don't have the gift of healing. But then, what do you think? He came and asked me. Maybe God said I didn't pray for the sister. You know, God prompted me to pray. Go in front and pray for the person. But because I held back, I feel bad. Did God take away my gift? No, the gift of God is irrevocable. It's still there. Alright? Stir it up, okay? And in Matthew chapter 25, verse 14, is a parable of the talents. A parable of the stewards. And there are three people. Jesus gave the story of a parable. It says the owner or the boss gave 5 talents to the first worker. Second one gave 2 talents, and the third one gave 1 talent, and he went away. Went on a business trip. So he said, take care of them, make sure you do your work. And when he came back, he asked for a reward. Okay, what have you done with the 5 talents? Oh, I managed to double it. Now I've got 10 talents. He says, and the boss is well done, good and faithful servant. Second one came, what do you do with 2 talents? Oh, boss, I multiply it, but 2 more. Very good. The last one, and then the last one, 1 talent, said, you only give me 1, ma. What to do with 1? Maybe you're saying, you know. Says, I know you're very stingy, ma, and then you will ask me to make report. I'm scared and lose it. I'm going to bury it. I dig a big hole and I bury it. So when you come back, I know where it is. Okay, so when the boss came back, he says, now there. Here's your 1 talent, give back to you. Was the boss very happy he got back 1 talent? No! The boss says, you lazy servant! You know, I could have given this 1 talent to the other person and he could have multiplied it. Don't say that I've only 1 talent or I've only 1 gift. The person who are gifted, get him to all the job. Oh, all of us are responsible of talents that God has given us. So when He comes and asks us to give account of the talents that He has given us, we will have a good report. Amen?
Amen.
Right. Okay, last slide is this. What? Last slide, huh? What I am is God's gift to me, right? God's given me a gift. What I do with it is my gift to Him. I ask you, what is your gift to God today? What can you bring back to God and says, God, thank you for giving me the gifts. I used it wisely. I used it. Tabernacle of Praise, your tagline is blessed to be a
blessing.
Yes, I got one sticker in my car. Blessed to be a blessing. You wonder, have I been a blessing this week? Who have I blessed? I prayed for somebody. Come for the prayer meeting and encourage someone. Have I smiled at somebody and tell them welcome? Have I given an encouraging word? Have I shared my meal with somebody? Have I opened my home and welcomed the sad people to come? Or said a good word to my neighbors? Or just ask them, why come to church with me this Sunday? Or will you church? So many things. Every one of you, spread out and be a blessing. Be a light. God bless you. Thank you.
She's wonderful. Celebrate this morning, no matter what your struggles are. We're going to celebrate. We're going to stand up now. I'm going to ask the musicians to come, and you can see Brother Jacob enjoys his gift. You know, in Jacob, isn't it? Am I correct? In worship. So, can everyone stand up with us this morning? We're just going to celebrate. Put aside all your challenges at this moment. Just thank God for the gift God has given you. If you are not sure you have a gift, come and see us. We are more than happy to run what we call the discovery course for you. Discovering your gift, discovering your personality, discovering your ministry. Some of you already know it. Let's just celebrate. Use it for God. We want everyone to discover it and use it for God's glory. Right? This is a new day for DOP. This is a new season for DOP. All that has happened in the past, we thank God we have learned from it. All the good that has happened, we rejoice in it. All the not so good that has happened, we cancel it. Somebody say cancel.
Yes.
We cancel it. It's all taken from the cross of Calvary. Hallelujah. This is a new day. All the young people from, I wanted to say 20 and below, but all those young people from 30 and below, we give Teresa a chance, okay? Come to the front. And those 30 and above can also come to the front. Alright? Now, let me see you this morning. They are young, they are energetic. We must encourage them with all the giftings. All come right, stand right in front of them. Alright, we are going to have a great time. Now this may not have happened before. morning, we are going to sing and we are going to dance. Hallelujah. Celebrate, all ready to sing, ready to dance, hallelujah, let's go! to be the revival meeting on Saturday afternoon, okay? Let's believe God that God's going to bring in all the young people into this church once again. Hallelujah. Once again. Wonderful. Dance here, all of you can do it, all right? At the right time, at the right place. Our legs shouldn't be too heavy, all right? I just want to do this, not because of enjoying it, but you know, praise is very powerful. Dancing is very powerful, done at the right time, at the right place. It actually gives us a breakthrough into the spiritual realm. It's a breakthrough. It removes all of the obstacles. It takes away all of that doubt, that fear, that uncertainty. Because when we praise God, He is enthroned in our praises. He is alive. He is present. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for this wonderful day. We thank you that we all have a gift from you. And we know, God, that we can continue to discover more of the gifts that you have blessed us with, so that we can be a blessing to those around us. We were born to be a blessor. You bless us. We are the children of Abraham. Hallelujah. Just as your promise to Abraham is, you will bless him, you will make him great, you will multiply his people. Father, we ask that you will bless us with the blessings of Abraham today. We are the inheritors of it. And whatever challenges that are along the way, we ask, God, that you will grant us the wisdom, the courage, the strength, Lord, to stay close to you, so that with every battle, there is always a victory. We will celebrate our victory. Today we celebrate, Lord. We celebrate who you are, what you have done for us. And we are not afraid of the future, no matter how uncertain it is. You are already there for us. You are our future. Hallelujah. All is under control because God is God Almighty. Fill our hearts with your presence, Lord, this morning. Be with us throughout the week as we do life together. Then when we come on Sunday, we celebrate that victory. Father, thank you so much for this wonderful group of people here. Thank you so much for loving us. Thank you so much for bringing us together as a community. Father, we just thank you and bless your wonderful name this morning. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
God bless you. Great. Ashes, ashes.